Today I'll be reviewing a very exciting camera, the Canon EOS R6. Now I've been shooting with this guy for the past 6 months and there is a lot to talk about. So what I want to do in this review is go over some of the most important specifications this camera has to offer, compare them to those of the R5, its bigger brother, then talk about things that matter for photography needs, such as ergonomics, how the camera handles in the field, image quality, and autofocus performance. And as you can see, I have a few Canon RF mount lenses in front of me here, so I'll be sharing my thoughts regarding the RF mount lineup as well. So let's get started. To be honest, I was genuinely impressed when Canon announced the R5 and R6 because I did not expect to see such rich set of features, especially after the launch of the original somewhat underwhelming EOS R. With a single SD memory card slot, no IBIS, and a silly touch bar that just didn't work, that camera felt more like an experiment rather than a serious tool. Now, with the launch of R5 and R6, things changed a lot. The touch bar thankfully went away in favor of proven classic Canon ergonomics, and these cameras now have a very rich set of features that make them stand out from the competition. In fact, the R5 is the first consumer-grade camera to feature 8K video shooting, and despite its 45-megapixel sensor resolution, its ability to shoot up to 12 frames per second using the mechanical shutter and up to 20 frames per second using the electronic shutter is truly an outstanding achievement. The jump from the original EOS R concept to these cameras was significant. In fact, as I'll detail later in this review, Canon went from being a subpar mirrorless company to one of the top players on the market in such a short period of time, and that's very impressive. I was especially surprised by the autofocus performance these cameras delivered compared to their predecessors. Now, let's get back to the EOS R6 and talk about its features and how they compare to those of R5. First of all, the R6 features a 20 megapixel full frame CMOS sensor, while the R5 has 45 megapixels. Clearly, Canon is aiming these cameras at different types of photographers. While the R5 is primarily aimed at landscape, architecture, and studio photographers who need as much resolution as possible, the R6 is more of a general purpose camera aimed for more everyday photography and videography needs. While these cameras share a lot of features, including the excellent dual pixel AF2 autofocus system, 5-axis image stabilization, Digic 10 image processors, and the same continuous shooting speed, there are some features that the R5 has that puts it in more of a premium category. First, there are a few ergonomic and functional differences between the two cameras. While both of them share a very similar rear layout, if you look at the top view, you'll realize that the R5 looks a lot like the original EOS R, with a top LCD screen and a new camera mode dial, while the R6 has a traditional camera mode dial and no top LCD. In terms of storage, the R5 has one CF Express memory card slot and one UHS-II compatible SD memory card slot, whereas the R6 has dual SD memory card slots, both of which are UHS-II compatible. Also, the R5 has better overall build quality, featuring full magnesium alloy shell and better weather sealing options, whereas the R6 has a bit more plastic in it, making it slightly lighter. In terms of electronic viewfinders, while both cameras share the same refresh rate, the R5 has a bit more resolution at 5.76 million dots, whereas the R6 has a 3.68 million dot EVF. Now, when it comes to rear LCD screens, the R5 also has a bit more resolution in comparison, but in real life, you can't really tell the difference. When it comes to video recording capabilities, the R5 is a much better choice, and not just because it can shoot in 8K, but it also provides more video options and formats in comparison, and because it features a metal rear plate, its heat dissipation properties are much better in comparison. So if you're shooting with both cameras, the R6 will not only overheat faster, but it will also require more cool down time. When I first experienced the quality of 8K video footage from the R5 and 4K video footage from the R6, I was very impressed. However, if I know that even after I apply all the latest firmware updates that these cameras can still overheat and not let me do the work, then I simply can't trust them for any serious jobs. And there are cameras out there that are much better in that regard. For example, right now you're watching footage from the Nikon Z6, which I've been using reliably for the last couple of years to shoot all kinds of 4K video projects. And even if I shoot that camera for more than 5-6 hours at a time, which sometimes happens, that camera never overheats. And there are other tools out there like the Sony A7S series or the Panasonic GH series that are arguably some of the best 4K cameras on the market today. Now, granted, none of those cameras have 8K shooting capability, but still, if you need to do serious work, then I would not consider these cameras. Now, there's one more thing to remember, that the timer for the overheating doesn't start from the moment you start recording the video. In fact, it starts from the moment you turn on the camera, which is even more disappointing. So for example, if you decided to use this for any serious work, and say you were at client site, and you turn on the camera, and you're working on your lighting, on your composition, and the client shows up 20 minutes later, you might only have 5 or 10 minutes of video shooting before the camera overheats. So keep this in mind, that could be a big problem. Now, if all you need to do is occasional 4K or 8K videos, and you don't mind the 30 minute or however long it takes for this camera to overheat, then by all means, these are really good cameras for that purpose. However, for any serious work, especially for paid client work, you do not want to use these cameras. All right, let's get back to our comparison. Aside from the features I already talked about, there are a few other minor differences here and there, but I'm not going to bother talking about them because they're not that important. The most important thing is when it comes to the overall experience of using these cameras, the consistency of the menu system, the button layout, and overall handling, they're very, very close. And as far as image quality, both are equally capable of producing excellent images. Now, one thing that I haven't talked about so far is pricing. And there's obviously a drastic difference in pricing between the two cameras. With the EOS R5 being a higher end camera and more premium camera, it's obviously going to have a higher price tag. And at $38.99, it is one of the most expensive full frame cameras on the market today. Whereas the R6 is priced much more reasonably at $24.99. Let's now talk about ergonomics and handling. Now, I previously mentioned ergonomics, but there are a few other things that I want to add, which will hopefully make it easier for anyone considering the R6. Now, if you're a Canon DSLR shooter and you're wondering about how easy it is to switch to the R6, you don't have to worry. Because if you look at the camera and the button layout, it will feel very, very similar to what you've previously seen on a Canon DSLR. And if you look at the menu system, it will also feel very familiar. In fact, I appreciate the fact that Canon engineers left a lot of the naming convention to be very similar, and the menu organization is just wonderful. Now, as a Nikon shooter, there are a few things that I wish Canon did a little bit differently, but that's being picky as a Nikon shooter. There are obviously things that I really like about Nikon, and there are things that I wish Nikon adopted from Canon as well. But in this particular case, I'm talking about the on-off switch. And Canon putting the on-off switch on the top left side of the camera here, or as we've previously seen, on the bottom of the rear of the camera, is not hugely convenient, because in order for me to turn on the camera, I have to use my other hand, then take a picture, and hopefully not forget to turn the camera off. With Nikons, I don't have to worry about that, because the on-off switch is right here where my index finger is, and I use the same finger for 4 different functions. Turn the camera on, focus, take a picture, turn the camera off. From that standpoint, I just get a lot more use out of a single finger, which is convenient, believe it or not. Now, it's not that big of a deal when you're using a DSLR, because if you leave a DSLR on, it doesn't really waste a lot of battery. Whereas with mirrorless cameras, it becomes more of a concern. For me, when I use my Z series cameras, I love the ability to just bring the camera to my face, turn on the camera, take a picture, turn the camera off, and I'm done. With the R5 and R6, I just need to remember that I have to use a different hand first of all, turn the camera on, take a picture, then bring it back, turn the camera off. It's just more movement, a little bit more inconvenient. But again, this is purely being a Nikon shooter. Now, if you're a Canon shooter, you're not gonna have a problem, because this is what Canon has always done, and they're just continuing with that trend. Now, as far as the overall menu system and the button layout and the handling of the camera in the field, it's wonderful. Even as a Nikon shooter, I thought it would take me more time to get used to the camera, because I was using the Z5 and the R6 together, side by side, when I was traveling with these two cameras, and I thought it would take me a lot of mental exercise to switch between the two systems. But to be honest, after using this camera heavily for about a week, it was very easy to transition. Now, in regards to the flip screen, I know some people love this thing, some people absolutely hate it. To be honest, This thing is more useful for people who want to do vlogging or do selfies where they want to be able to point the camera at themselves and see what they're recording. With the video recording limitations of this camera and the overheating problems, I would say the flippy screen is probably not necessary, but it can be used, and I really like the fact that you can actually close it up like that, and when you store it or when you transport it, you don't have to worry about scratching the screen. So that is a good feature, but overall, I don't know if I like the flippy part of it. I don't like how the camera becomes bigger and extends to the side, and if you're using an L bracket, this could be a problem because when you're doing this, you're gonna be hitting the L bracket. So I don't know if I like that. And if I need to only use one plate on the bottom and move away from an L bracket, I don't know if I would consider this to be a worthy move for me. So I personally prefer just a regular tilting screen or the screen that Fuji has done on its GFX series and the higher end XT series, which is just a regular tilt screen, but it also has the ability to go up and down. So that screen to me is probably the most ideal design. Maybe some of the Pentax cameras as well, because they can do all kinds of different crazy movement. So those LCD screens I really appreciate. This one, I'm not so sure. So again, for most people, this is probably not going to be a problem, and some people probably even prefer to have a flip screen like this. But for me personally, like I said, the other way, just a regular tilt screen that goes up and down for both vertical and horizontal orientation is probably something easier. Moving on, let's talk about a very exciting camera feature, which is in-body image stabilization, or IBIS. And the reason why it's exciting is because this one feature is something we've previously never seen on a Canon DSLR or a mirrorless camera. Now, the R5 and R6 have both a brand new 5-axis image stabilization, and it works really well. Now, if you're wondering how well it works and how effective it is when using with a variety of different lenses, I would say if you're looking for a good excuse to upgrade, this would be it, because yes, it's that good. Now, Canon has some really crazy claims when it comes to the effectiveness of its IBIS, which it claims up to 8 stops of compensation. I don't think that's a very realistic number, to be honest, because the best that I could get was about 5 to 6 stops, and that's using some of the best lenses according to Canon that should be able to get up to 8 stops of compensation. And that list includes the 24-105 f4, as well as the 85mm 1.2 that I've got here. So depending on the type of lens that you use, you should be able to get very good compensation or pretty decent compensation. I would say the realistic number is between 3 to 6 stops, depending on how shaky your hands are. Now, another thing to note is that the IBIS really depends on the focal length as well. For example, if you use super telephoto lenses like this 800mm f11 or the 600mm f11 or even a 7200mm f2.8, depending on the focal length, the effectiveness of IBIS is going to increase or decrease. Even with this lens at 24mm, you're going to get much better stabilization than say at 105mm. So keep that in mind. The longer the lens, the more important that lens has its own stabilization. And this camera is intelligent enough to be able to switch between those different stabilization methods. And that's why it is able to sometimes even utilize both. So keep that in mind. When it comes to image quality, as you can see from some of the sample photos in this review, the R6 is capable of producing excellent results. Images shot at low to medium ISOs between 100 and 6400 are superb, with very little noise and highlights and the shadows. And when combined with the excellent 5-axis IBIS, you don't need to worry about using a tripod in most situations just to keep the camera ISO lower. In terms of high ISO performance, the image sensor of the R6 can be directly compared to some of the best sensors on the market. When comparing ISO performance between this camera and the Nikon Z6 II, both yield very clean images all the way to ISO 6400, and only when pushing ISO above 12,800 you start noticing a little bit of noise. As you push ISO higher, you obviously see quite a bit of more grain, along with some loss of colors and detail, but that's expected from any camera. When it comes to dynamic range, the R6 once again does not disappoint. If Canon previously got a lot of negative feedback for relatively poor dynamic range performance of its previous generation sensors, this is certainly not the case with the R6. As you can see from these comparisons, the R6 has similar dynamic range both in terms of highlight and shadow recovery when compared to the Nikon Z6 II, which is very impressive. What about autofocus performance? Now, this is one area that really surprised me because I did not expect to see such a vast improvement in autofocus performance when comparing the previous generation cameras like the EOS R with the current generation R5 and R6 that feature a brand new dual pixel AF2 autofocus system. Now, you might be wondering how different these systems are. And if you were to put the EOS R together with something like the R6 side by side and you photographed some fast action, you will notice the difference right away. It's basically a night and day difference. The new autofocus system is vastly superior in so many ways. Now, I've been using this camera for the past 6 months or so, and I can tell you with confidence that this is one of the best autofocus systems on the market today. And to be able to say that about a relatively new system, especially when you compare it to something like Sony that has been changing and upgrading its system every generation, and their new A9 II is an incredible camera that has all that those real-time AF features and artificial intelligence, that's a pretty incredible achievement on behalf of Canon. Now, I'm not just saying it because I do want to talk about specific examples where I believe that this camera actually excels and even exceeds the performance of something like the Sony A9 II. For example, for regular portrait work, you might think, well, you know, how different would this system be compared to something like the Sony A9 II, which is already an incredible machine? I agree, for stationary subjects, all of these cameras deliver, and that includes the Nikon system as well. However, as soon as the subject starts moving and you start tracking that subject, that's when the autofocus systems begin to get real challenges. Now, with this camera, it can shoot up to 12 frames per second with the mechanical shutter while the autofocus system is fully engaged. And that's not something that many other autofocus systems can do. And the R5, by the way, can do the same thing. If you compare that to the capabilities of the Sony A9 II, it's limited to 10 frames per second. So in some ways, this camera is already beating the A9 II. But it's one thing to just have a better spec and a completely different to actually look at photos. Now let's take a look at one case scenario. I asked my daughter to do some modeling for me. She was running towards the camera and I photographed her while the autofocus system was engaged. And shooting at 12 frames per second and seeing that most of the images were coming out tack sharp, that was something I've never previously experienced before, because one thing that's really interesting here was that I was using the 85mm 1.2 lens set to its maximum aperture of 1.2. Now, obviously, this is a very sharp lens and it delivers really good results at that maximum aperture. But again, considering how thin the depth of field is and considering how fast my daughter was running, to be able to get so many in-focus shots, it means that this camera at 12 frames per second is able to send the instruction to this lens that can focus fast enough and keep up with this 12 frames per second shooting. That's an incredible achievement. So in some ways, I would say this is already so impressive that I would say for portraiture work, for sports and action photography like this, this is one of the best cameras out there. Now, there are other things that the camera excels in. And if you're wondering about wildlife photography, I would say if you are a birder and really love photographing little birds, this is another killer system. Now, I've used many different autofocus systems before, but I've never been able to get to the point where any of the cameras can find a bird, identify the eye, and track the eye of the bird. Even the Sony A9 II cannot do this. Now, maybe Sony will bring it out in the future as a feature upgrade, but right now, that camera cannot do what this camera can, which is it is able to do exactly that. Now, I was using this RF 800mm f11 lens together with the 600mm f11 lens to do some photography of birds. And I can tell you, boy, just putting these lenses on this camera and just pointing at the bird and seeing how fast the autofocus system can not only detect and find the bird, but also detect the eye of the bird, That was an incredible experience on its own. And I already talked about how impressed I was with the system in my Nikon Z5 review, where I specifically gave examples of these little birds that were hopping in different branches and how the camera was able to keep the eye of the bird always in focus. This is something that this camera can do together with the R5. So if you're looking for an ultimate bird photography camera, I would say either the R5 or the R6 are going to be excellent candidates. Now, when it comes to buffer capacity, this camera doesn't disappoint either because it can shoot all the way to 200 frames before the buffer fills up. And that's plenty for any type of action shooting. So overall, if you were to ask my opinion about what I think about the autofocus system on the R6 and R5, I would say it's pretty incredible. I'm very happy about these changes, and I'm happy to see that Canon is continuing to advance its autofocus system. Let's now talk about battery life. While Canon says that you can get up to 380 shots using the EVF and up to 510 shots using the LCD before the battery runs out, I can tell you that my field experience was very different. In fact, I was getting between 800 to 1,000 shots when I was making sure that I was taking a shot, turning off the camera, and only turning it on when I needed to. So depending on your shooting style, you might get a lot more images or maybe even less images. If you forget to turn off the camera and you have some really strange timer set up where the camera continues to operate, then in those situations, you can count on the battery life being wasted very quickly and you might only get a few shots before the battery runs out. All right, let's wrap up this review. As you can see, there's a lot to like about the Canon EOS R6. It has wonderful ergonomics and handling, its menu system is well organized, its autofocus performance is amazing, and when it comes to image quality, it certainly does not disappoint. So if you're looking for a great full frame camera to transition to, or if you're a current Canon DSLR shooter and you are exploring the mirrorless system, this is definitely a camera I can recommend.